Today we're going to be talking about science and Christianity. And as a way to get the thing started, let me tell you a little story that was actually on a series called Cosmos. It's a science series. Maybe some of you have seen it. It's popular, beautifully shot. It's a reboot of the old series with Carl Sagan back in the, I think it was the 70s, maybe early 80s. This is with Neil deGrasse Tyson. Now in the very first episode, when they're introducing themselves to the new audience, they spent roughly one quarter of the time telling a story about a man named Giordano Bruno. Now Bruno was what they claim as an early scientist. He's the man on the left there, and he got in trouble with the church. And I don't know if you can see it very well here, but it's in a told in a sort of a cartoon-like format. And they have these ghouled, horrible-looking churchmen that come to Bruno. And because of his science, his love of science, they squash him and end up killing him. They put him to death because he loved science. That's the story that's being told. So do you see what's going on? The idea is that Christianity and science butt heads. That's the story out there. Later on, there were two books in the 1800s that became very, very popular and spread this idea of that clash between Christianity and science. One was by a man named Draper over on the left, the other by a man named White on the right. And look at the titles. History of the Conflict Between Religion and Science. And of course, when they mean religion, they spend their time talking about Christianity in particular. So here's Christianity and here's science, and they butt heads. Same idea over here, a history of the warfare between science, a history of the warfare of science with theology and Christendom. So again, science, Christianity, banging heads. These two caught on and became the story for the 1900s and clear into the 2000s today. That science and Christianity are enemies, they've always been enemies, that Christianity was always trying to push science down. So that's what we're going to investigate today. Let's start with talking first about how science works. Just so we have a clear idea, this is modern science. It starts with an observation. Somebody looks at something. So I'm going to use an example here that was probably 20, 30 years ago. They discovered a layer of clay in this one area, down deep, far down. They found this layer of clay that had iridium, a thin layer of iridium all the way through it. Iridium is a metal. So that's the first thing they notice. They come across it and they say, gee, I wonder how that iridium got there. So the hypothesis, the guess, the best estimate, how'd we get this? Maybe because asteroids out there in space have a heavy concentration of iridium, maybe an asteroid smashed into the Earth, kicked up all sorts of debris, it filtered down with the iridium, landed, and it was covered over years and created this layer in the Earth. So that's the story. That's the hypothesis. Well, you don't just stop on the hypothesis, do you? If you're a scientist, you then have to figure out, how can we prove it? How can we prove it? Experimentation of some kind. So what did they do? They looked for other sites with iridium, and they found it all across the world, iridium at this one certain layer. And they also found, later on, a huge impact crater. And they said, okay, there it is. So the verification was the other sites, and so people nod their heads yes, they give it a thumbs up. That appears to be the best way to understand this event. But that's science in action. Observe something, make a hypothesis to make the best guess about why you think it's there, do an experiment, and it'll either find that what you hypothesized was true or not true. So that's verification. So that's just the modern picture of what we mean by science. Well, I want people to understand one thing as far as history goes. Modern science developed not despite Christianity, but because of Christianity. That's a huge claim, isn't it? It didn't come along fighting Christianity. It was Christianity that birthed it. And by the way, I'm not the only one that says this. This is acknowledged as the truth by non-Christians. So this is not me as a Christian standing here trying to convince you of something that's not true. People worldwide, historians, buy into this. So the question would be, well, what is there about Christianity and the Judeo-Christian worldview? Judeo meaning the Jews. So the Jews and the Christians both honor the Bible as their holy book. What is there about the revelations in that book, as opposed to other holy books, that would have caused people to say, I think we can do science, the science I was just talking about? Well, here are some of the things. Let's talk about them just briefly. What do you learn about God in the Old Testament when he's creating things? It's a very rational, step-by-step, methodical, almost an engineering approach to the creation. I mentioned that one time to a class that was composed of a lot of engineers, and they all started clapping. So you get the Genesis account that sounds a little bit like engineering. Second thing, when people are created, it says, let us make man in our image. Now, obviously, we don't look like God, but there's something in our souls, there's something in our brains that is at least a small picture of what God is like. And so can you see how that would give you great confidence if you're interested in exploring nature, that you had some sort of rationality to be able to go out and understand the world? God gave you that ability. Thirdly, God, according to Genesis, is separate from his creation. He's not in the tree, he's not in the rock, he's not in the water. And that's a good thing. Why do I say that? Well, you wouldn't cut a tree down and you wouldn't do experiments if you thought God was in something. Does that make sense? Yeah, you leave it alone. You don't want to mess. You're hurting God. You're maybe making the gods angry. So we say, no, God is separate from the creation. You can go out and look at a tree, look at an animal, do experiments, and you're not going to get God hurt in some way. Fourth, the world is real. Some places, some religions say this world is Maya. It's an illusion. We don't say that. Christians don't say that. They say this is a world. There really is a world out there. So you're not wasting your time investigating an illusion. You're looking at the real thing, the authentic thing. Next, nature is called good. Do you notice how many times in Genesis God saw what was going on in his creation? He said, it is good. So it's nothing to be afraid of. This is something very positive that we can go out and take a look at if we're scientists. Next, God is unchanging. He's orderly. He's not whimsical. So whatever laws of nature that are put into effect, they still operate today. The sun is always going to rise in the same spot. The tides will work the same way. The atoms are going to do their thing. Gravity will work a certain way. It's not on and off, depending on the whim of a god. That's huge. That's a major thing. Scientists say we feel comfortable looking at nature because we think there are laws in effect that are rational and understandable, logical, and organized. What great confidence that would give somebody to go exploring nature. And finally, it's the Judeo-Christian view that says history is going someplace. We're not on a hamster wheel. You ever seen those little wheels the hamsters get on to exercise? Do they get anywhere when they're on those wheels? No. It's good for them, good exercise, but they don't get anywhere. Well, some different religions believe everything is cyclical. It just goes on, and nothing ever happens, nothing ever changes. You want to get off that wheel, in fact. Some of the Eastern religions believe that. But that's not what the Western world says. That's not what the Judeo-Christian view says. It says we are going someplace. There is a plan in effect, and there is an optimistic movement towards something. And so if you're a scientist, you believe that as you work on things, you can make things better. You can have improvements. Something is going to come about as a result that's a positive thing. So these are just some, and there are other qualities about the Judeo-Christian worldview, but all of these things, do you notice they don't talk about a clash with science? This is what gave birth to modern science. That's why it came out in the Western world, not in Asia, not in Africa, not in the Arab world. It was the Judeo-Christian world that gave us modern science. What about comments like this, though? Well, you've got the medieval world as an example. Hey, during that time, the Catholic Church ran things, and it was dark. They called it the Dark Ages. By the way, historians are saying now, get rid of that term. Don't use that term, Dark Ages. Because it was actually a time of great inventiveness. It was a time of technology. I just gave you a list of a few things. Crop rotation, the whole understanding of that was developed. The plow iron tools, blast furnace, windmills, water wheels. It is absolutely incorrect to call it the Dark Ages. Medicine, universities were founded. Christians founded the universities. Moving ahead a little bit in time, but when Americans came over here, the first colonists, after setting up their church, after setting up their homes, they set up universities. This doesn't sound like a clash between thinking, learning, and Christianity. Absolutely not. Let's move through some history of science. Remember I told you the story of Giordano Bruno and the way Cosmos presented it? Here's what they tell you. The show says he was persecuted by the church because he was scientific. The church didn't want anybody to talk about science. They wanted to live in superstition. And church people were those cartoon ghouls that were coming after him. Well, what's the reality? Well, let me say this first of all. It was absolutely wrong of the church to put this man to death. I'm not vindicating them. I'm not trying to say that was fine. Absolutely not. He was involved in magic. He was involved in the dark arts. He held heretical religious views. He was not, underline, he was not a martyr to science. This is not the story of an early scientist who says, hey guys, and then gets slammed by the church. Absolutely not. He challenged the authority. He challenged the teachings. He was causing problems within the Catholic community. And as a result, he got himself into some major trouble and eventually got put to death. Absolutely wrong. Terrible thing to do. But the story has been twisted incorrectly to make it sound like this poor guy was a martyr to science. This is around 1600. Well, here's somebody else in the 1600s who gets into trouble. And again, the story gets spun as if Galileo, there he is on the right, as if Galileo was, again, a martyr to science. That he fought Christianity, and Christianity finally slammed him and knocked him out. And part of that story is that he got tortured, that he was imprisoned. Those things are not true at all. Here's where it's a complicated story, so I'm not going to spend a lot of time on it. But just keep in mind that it's not Galileo against Christianity. Galileo took on Aristotle. And many Christians at the time, especially those scholastics, the ones who ran the universities, had bought into Aristotle's theories. And Aristotle's theories, I mean, some of them were terrific, but he's a Greek from hundreds and hundreds of years before. And so his ideas were often mistaken, and Galileo took him on. And those scholastics, their jobs were on the line if Galileo can find problems with Aristotle. And Galileo did a lot of other things. He was a kind of an obnoxious person. He took on the Pope, ridiculed people in the church. He was brought before the Inquisition and told to renounce these ideas. And he said, okay. He was never tortured. He was never in prison. He was placed in house arrest. But the story that's been told to you, that it's Galileo against Christianity, absolute nonsense. He was a Christian, a devout Christian his whole life. He was opposed to this philosophical underpinning that was going on at the time, not only among the church people, but others, of Aristotle. Let's move on a little further. Let's get into the later 1600s. Science grew under the Reformation. Of course, the Reformation starts with Luther, and then Zwingli and Knox and Calvin and all these early reformers. Did they turn their back on science? Was it the Catholics were okay with it, and then the reformers come along and they hated science? No. Again, not true at all. Science flourished. Science grew during the Reformation. One example. Guess who started the Royal Society in England? That's still around today. It's the premier scientific society started in England, clear back in the 1600s. It's still around today. It was started by Puritans. You can't get much more basic as for your Christianity than Puritans. They started the Royal Society. They loved science. And some of these early people during the Reformation were Christians. Isaac Newton. That's Newton. He was their president. Robert Boyle. Many Christian scientists. In fact, I just have a partial list here of scientists who saw no problem in combining their faith with their research in science. So here are some of those heavy hitters. Look at those names. I'm just going to pick one out of here, Kepler. He's the one that figured out how the planets go around the sun. They don't go around the sun in a perfect circle. they do an ellipse, which is sort of a squashed circle. And he formulated a lot of laws, a great observer of the skies. He said, talking about his research, he said, "I'm just thinking God's thoughts after him." Do you hear that confidence? Do you hear that? He's talking about going out. He knows God was a rational thinker, and then he says, if God's rational and he gave me some of that ability, I should be able to think God's thoughts after him. Not to say I'm as good as God, he's just saying, I should be able to find out how God put some of this together. Great optimism. Not a clash. None of these people saw a clash between their faith and science. So when did it change? Where is this hostility coming from? Well, it came about during a period called the Enlightenment. Don't you love that title, by the way? Do you hear what that suggests? That there was this dark age, and then somebody struck a match. Somebody lit the torch, and let there be light. And it drove away superstition, and it drove away Christianity, and it drove away other religions. And finally, light came to just the rational people. Well, in the 1600s and 1700s, you have some of these names down here, Descartes and Rousseau and Voltaire and Locke. You get this thing called deism, which is a religious belief. You know, in the Judeo-Christian view, God is very interactive with his people. He helps Moses. He does miracles during the times of the prophets. Jesus comes and works miracles and brings the word of God to people. That's the traditional Christian message. But deism says, no, God is like the original starter of everything. He wound it all up like a major clock, set it down, and then he's gone. You're on your own. He does not interact with this world. He does not do miracles. Thomas Jefferson, for example, a pretty good example of a deist, he went through his New Testament, cut out all the parts where Jesus was performing miracles, and called his, what was left, it was called the Jefferson Bible. I think you can still get them today. But that's his idea. So what happens? Well, we get the box. What do I mean by the box? During this time, people said, science should only explore inside the box called naturalism, or naturalistic science. So what do I mean by that? The box is the material world. So it's space, and it's the earth, and it's gravity, and it's all this stuff that we're made of. And the idea is scientists should only work with that. They shouldn't think about a God outside the box interacting with the box. The box is all you have. And so we've got this naturalistic science going on today. I'll show you more about that coming up when we talk about scientism. But I just want you to see that was the philosophy. Exclude anything that's theological. Exclude anything that can't fit in the box of naturalism, nature. I don't mean just nature like trees, but the world, the whole system. But you know what's interesting? In the last 30, 40, 50 years, this box is starting to look like it's opening and allowing an interaction with God. That's what's starting to happen. What do I mean by that? Let's just take one thing here, the Big Bang. What's going on with that? Well, you got the box. If the box is the universe, the question is, how'd that get started? How do you get the box in the first place? Where'd that box come from? Where did matter, space, time, and energy come from? Because scientists say now, they're settled on the idea of a Big Bang. That 13, 14 billion years ago or whenever, that nothing gave rise to everything. That from nothing came the universe. All the stuff you see around us today, all those galaxies out there in space, the Earth spinning around, the planets, the gas, the nebulas, all that sort of stuff was at one time nothing. And then it sprang into existence. How do you get something from nothing? Well, it sounds like then you have a supernatural start to the universe. Nature can't give birth to itself. Does that make sense? Anything that comes into existence needs a cause. You look at a car, when it comes down the factory line, did that car just pop into existence? No, it started out as pieces of metal, and people worked and put it all together. Where'd the metal come from? They went and dug it out of hills and smelted it and all this sort of stuff. So anything that comes into existence needs a cause. The universe came into existence. That needs a cause. A great argument is that God is that cause. So look at that naturalistic box that we were talking about before is starting to open up to say, you know, it's possible that there is a God that created that box in the first place. How about the fine-tuned universe? I don't have time to go into a lot of details on this, but I just want you to keep in mind that everything from way out in space down to inside your body, it looks like there's unbelievable design going on. And things appear to be fine-tuned for us to be here. Gravity has to be a certain way. The expansion of the universe has to be just right. Our Earth has to be just right. The Sun has to be just right. We have to have the right kinds of planets, the right kind of atmosphere. We have to be in the right spot of the galaxy. We have to be in the right kind of galaxy. And it goes on, and it goes on, and it goes on. It's unbelievable, all the things that you need. So I'm going to skip over this, if that's okay. By the way, if you have any questions about anything that I'm saying, or you want some more details, if you just contact me, that's Gary@apologeticsforlife.org. It's all one word, apologeticsforlife.org. And I'll be glad to send you more information or answer any questions that you might have. But just because of time, I think I'll move along here. Here comes the problem today. Science has never been a problem for Christians. We've just been talking about that. Science is not the problem. What is the problem? Well, it's something that's starting to develop now that's known as scientism. Not science, but scientism. So what are we talking about here? Well, let's look at these two terms and see if we can figure out what we mean by them. What's science? Science is just a way to investigate the world. We talked about that. You go out and you make an observation and try to guess why that is the way it is, do some experiments. So you're just looking at the world and you follow any lead, whatever it is. So if you look at the beach, if you guys walk out to the beach and you see somebody has scratched in the sand, John loves Mary, and then drew a big heart, you look at that and you say, that looks like design. I think somebody did that. You don't say, gosh, look how the waves formed that. The crabs walked around in a certain way and formed John Loves Mary. No, you say that's design. But scientism says, nope, you can't do that. You can't go there. Scientism is a worldview. What do I mean by a worldview? A worldview is just a way that you make sense of the world. It's, in a sense, the glasses that you wear to try to understand reality. So scientism is a worldview. What are their glasses like? Well, they say this: science is the only reliable source of truth. You can't know for sure if something is true unless you can prove it scientifically. That's their view of reality. They're in that box, and that's all they're going to deal with, just the stuff in the box that science looks at. That's their view of reality. So when they look at Genesis, when it says, in the beginning God, they're going to take the word God out. Their worldview sees it as this: in the beginning, the particles. And that's all they're going to deal with, those particles, those early elements and how they changed and transformed and brought about us and planets and stars and the whole universe. That's their focus. And they say that's where you find truth. That's where all of life should be. It's the only reliable source of truth. And let me make a special comment here, because I don't want people to think that every scientist buys into this. Not true. Many scientists don't buy into scientism. There are still plenty of good scientists today, some have won the Nobel Prize, who are firm believers in God. I'll just give you one example. Maybe some of you recognize the name Francis Collins. Francis Collins, years back when Clinton was president, was head of the Human Genome Project. They're the ones that went through and took the DNA structure, and they were able to map the human genome, where everything was in line there as far as hair color and prone to diseases and all this stuff that you could work out on the human genome. It's an amazing thing to have. And he was honored by Clinton, stood alongside of him. Well, Francis Collins at one time was not a believer. He was a doctor, and he went around to the bedside. He was in a terminal ward where people were dying. And a lady said to him, so what do you believe? Because she seemed pretty content and satisfied with what was going to happen to her. She said, what do you believe? as far as religion goes. And Collins was kind of dumbfounded. He had never thought of it before. And he said, I don't know. Afterwards, he thought, I'm a scientist. I should know this. I should be interested in this. So he started as a scientist. He started reading comments about religions. He started reading holy books. He got so confused. He was just absolutely spun around. And down the road from where he lived, there was a pastor. And he sat down with a pastor and he said, I am really lost. And he started rambling and things, and the pastor was kind of smiling at him. He said, here, read this. And he handed him a copy of C.S. Lewis's book, Mere Christianity. So he took that book home. And if you don't know anything about Mere Christianity, C.S. Lewis wrote this back in the 40s, based on some radio broadcasts that he did. It lays out very clearly the Christian message. And when he read this, he was struck by the truth of it. And he has become, Francis Collins is an out-and-out good Christian guy these days. Take a look at YouTube, you can find things about him. So I don't want you to think that all scientists are buying into this scientism. Absolutely not true. But unfortunately, there are enough of them out there that it's causing a problem in continuing this idea that science and religion are two very different things and they don't agree and they clash all the time. Let me show you an example of I gave you a definition, but I want you to see what it looks like in action, scientism. So this is Richard Lewontin. He's an evolutionary biologist. And years ago, he wrote an article, I think it was in the New York Times Review of Books. So that's pretty influential. So this is a long piece, and I just put some of it up here on the screen. But I want you to look at what he is saying about how he and science approaches things. We, that'd be scientists, we take the side of science in spite of the patent absurdity of some of its constructs, in spite of its failure to fulfill many of its extravagant promises, because we have a prior commitment to materialism. We are forced by our a priori, that means made before you examine anything, we are forced by our a priori adherence to material causes, no matter how counterintuitive. That materialism is absolute, for we cannot allow a divine foot in the door. Now, we have to unpack that a little bit, don't we? What he says is powerful, but let's pull it apart. We take the side of science in spite of the patent absurdity of some of its constructs. Richard Dawkins said it this way. He said, the world looks like it's constructed. It looks like it's designed. In other words, if you were just to go with common sense, you'd go toward the idea of an engineer, a God behind everything. And then he has to say that's not really the way it is. So that's what Lewontin says. He said, science often stakes out absurd positions. And it doesn't fulfill many of its extravagant promises. So you'd say, well, if they are buying into absurd ideas and they make promises they can't fulfill, why are they doing this? Here's why. Because, he says, we have a prior commitment. In other words, before they even go and look at the evidence, they have a prior commitment to materialism, just the stuff of the universe. Do you see that as scientism? That's naturalism. Let's just stay within that box. That's all we're going to do. We're forced, he says, to look for material causes. No divine, no God, no theology involved, no thank you. We're going to look and see what material causes there are. And that's all we've got. So in the box, all they have for how life came about is evolution. And I do a talk on this. You can look at it on my website, apologeticsforlife.org. I do a talk about creation and evolution. Even evolutionary scientists who are not Christians are shaking their heads. They're saying, we need a new idea. This doesn't work very well. But they're stuck with it because it's in the box. They don't want to open up the box because that would lead to maybe a possibility of a God. So he says, we're forced to adhere to material causes no matter how counterintuitive. They don't even make sense to us. But we have to do that because we can't allow a divine foot in the door. So let me give you an illustration of really how crazy this position is. It sounds kind of nuts, but let me take it one step further. So I said at the bottom of the slide here, Imagine a police station. So here's what I want you to do. Let's pretend that all of you are detectives. And I'm the chief of police. I walk in the room one day and say, okay, everybody be quiet. You know about this string of homicides that we've had. 7 people killed in the last 10 days. We've got to catch that person who's responsible. You're all assigned to that. Forget what you're doing. Put that all aside. Every one of you are going to go out until we find this person. Oh, and by the way, don't implicate a white person. Well, if you're a detective, wouldn't your question, the first question that comes to mind is, but what if all of the clues, what if all of the witnesses, what if all of the evidence points toward a white person? What are we supposed to do? That's crazy. Do you see this chief of police says, I want you to stay in this box. Don't look out of the box. Inside the box, it's going to say minorities. Well, you'd say that's a crazy way to run a police station. They should get rid of that chief of police. Sure. You don't want to have a box. You don't want to be restricted as a policeman. But do you see what Lewontin is doing? He is restricting science. He says we've got to deal only in the box. But my question is, and a lot of people's question is, but what if there is a divine interaction somehow with the universe? Oh no, we can't have that, says Lewontin. That's scientism. That's naturalism. It goes by several different terms. Materialism, that's all there is to the universe. And science is the only place we can get good information. Let me give you a couple more examples of scientism. Richard Dawkins, everybody's favorite atheist. If you want to quote an atheist, you always go to Richard Dawkins. Here's what Dawkins said one time. He was trying to describe love. Now, think about him. For him, it's all the box. It's just compounds and chemicals and neurons firing and electricity, and that's it. It's just the box. He said, love is a product of highly complicated nervous equipment or computing equipment of some sort. Try that when you're on a date and your partner says to you, do you love me? And you say, well, yeah, if you mean by love a product of highly complicated nervous equipment or computing equipment, then yes, I love you. That's not what the person wants to hear. That means that's out of your control. Your love is just chemicals. Well, your chemicals might change. People's chemicals change. Then you're not going to love that person very long. That's not a stable relationship there, is it? The other person's probably going to walk away from you if that's your answer. How about Carl Sagan? Look how he constructed the box. He said, the universe is all there is or ever was or ever will be. The universe, that box, that's all there is, all there was, all there ever will be. There will not be a divine action into that box. One more example of scientism. Remember, they view science as the only place to get reliable information. That's the only source of truth. Well, here's a man, Steven Pinker, he's an evolutionary psychologist. Here's what he had to say. Science is indispensable in all areas of human concern. Not some, all areas, including politics. Okay, well, there's political science. I think I'm okay with that. The arts? Really? I thought the arts were about beauty and lifting spirits and touching our souls. He says, no, it's indispensable for the arts and the search for meaning, purpose, and morality. Really? Science will tell us morality. I'm just blown away by that. What a statement. Science will give us the search for morality. I'd like 2 pounds of morality, please. Tell me when you've ever seen morality under a microscope. When have you ever figured out the compound for morality? How many atoms are in morality? That makes no sense to me. That's what he says. Other forms of knowledge, he says, like faith or revelation or experience. He says they're generators of error. Only science will give us the truth. Everything else will give you error. So forget your experience, and certainly forget revelation, like the Bible. Finally, here's what else he said. The moral worldview of any scientifically literate person, one who's not blinkered by fundamentalism, do you know what blinkers are? You put them on a horse so the horse doesn't get distracted by things off to the side. So the horse can only see a certain way. So he says, fundamentalism, of course he's generally talking about Christianity here, fundamentalism will give you a small picture of the world. It doesn't allow you to see the rest of the world out around you. So he says, the moral worldview of any scientifically literate person requires a radical break from religious conceptions of meaning and value. We got to get rid of those religious conceptions of meaning and value. Let me just tell you one thing that scares me to death about this. If this wins out, if this becomes the view, then please take very, very good care of yourself, because if you should become incapacitated somehow, you should become bedridden, you should have some chronic illness that lays you low, a scientific person is going to say you don't have value, you're not made in the image of a God. Remember, there's no God. You are valuable only if you produce. And you're lying in bed. You're not producing. Well, guess what? That's not too far away from saying, maybe you shouldn't be here. Maybe we should take you out, literally, out of this world. You see what's going on there? If we get rid of the value from a religious perspective, that no matter what we look like, no matter what our ability level, no matter how weak we are, no matter what illnesses may strike us, no matter our age, we have value because we're made in the image of God. There's something different about human beings. You gas termites, but you don't gas people. But that all goes out the window if you buy into scientism. Can you see that one more time? You have to have a radical break of this idea of meaning and science and value. Science will determine meaning and value. Well, all they can do is look at what you're contributing to society. And your value may not be very great. So therefore, maybe you shouldn't get any money. Maybe you should have to be forced into some place. Eventually, maybe we should move you out of the whole world. What are some of the problems with scientism? I've touched on them just a little bit. But let's explore these for just a few minutes here. One problem with scientism. It lessens human value. I just said that, didn't I, a couple minutes back. Let me give you an example from a book. It's a powerful book. And remember how I mentioned C.S. Lewis a few minutes ago with Mere Christianity? Well, Lewis also wrote, that was a Christian book. He also wrote a series of children's stories that really explain the entire gospel and tell what it's like to be a Christian. It was called The Chronicles of Narnia. And they've been making them into movies. I hope they continue with them. The Lion, Witch, and the Wardrobe was the first one. That's probably the best one to go to look at the whole big picture of Christianity. Because Aslan, I won't give away the story if you haven't seen it before, but Aslan is a huge lion. And he is the Christ character, as Lewis tells his story there of what happens to Aslan. So he's created Christian books, nonfiction. He's created fiction books that tell about Christianity, their theology, with a lot of fun when you read them. But he's got this other series of books that are science fiction novels. And I've taught science fiction. I love science fiction. He's got this trilogy, Out of the Silent Planet, that deals with Mars, Paralandra, that deals with Venus, and he's got this third one called That Hideous Strength. So just let me tell you something about them real quickly. They all are informed by and carry a very strong Christian view. So it's science fiction from a theological perspective. Very interesting. So in his last story, the last one in that trilogy called That Hideous Strength, he's got scientists, and this is pretty good for Lewis. Back in the 40s and 50s, he could see this coming. He started talking about scientists who wanted to tear loose from the Judeo-Christian worldview and just see everything in terms of science. Science is it. We're back to that box again. So he's got one of his characters saying this. If science is really given a free hand, it can now take over the human race and recondition it, make man a really efficient animal. Is that what we really want for the human race? That's called reductionism, when you reduce people to parts, or reduce people, in this case, to animals. And look what you have to do to get them that way. You have to recondition them. You have to get them to think a little differently. Well, how are you going to do that? I don't know, maybe actual camps that you have to go to and you have to be reconditioned. But do you see what they're trying to say? Strip away, like that other person says, strip away their old ways of thinking about morality. Get that out of there. Get the religious views out. Get the theological views out. Get the concept of God out of there. Put that away. And then you recondition them. Because what have you got left? If you take away their soul, take away their spirit, take away the idea of a God, what do you have? You have a body. But animals have bodies. So we're just another animal. Well, if you can train animals, you can train people. But the first step is you got to get rid of that quality that made them different from animals, that quality of a soul or a spirit inside them. No, they're just animals. They're just meat all the way through. They're just walking machines. And boy, you could really make people efficient. That's the goal, efficiency. So again, let's think about that person who's lying in a bed. Is that person efficient? No. Does that person take up resources? Yes. Is that person contributing to society? No. So wait a minute. So if the measurement is how efficient are you, and you're not very efficient, we check all the boxes, we enter all the numbers, add up your numbers. Sorry, your numbers aren't very good. You're not very efficient. So what's ahead for you? Well, it won't be good. Whatever. So first problem is, it takes away the specialness of human nature. It takes away the difference between us and animals. It brings people crashing down into just another animal. What else does it have as a problem? It's self-refuting. Now, I've talked about this with critical thinking, but let's just take a second. What does it mean to make a self-refuting statement? It's when your statement doesn't match up with reality. In other words, it destroys itself. So I'll give you an example. Somebody says, I can't speak a word of English. Really? You just did. That sentence, we don't have to pay any attention to it because it's illogical. It's not logical. Here's another one. No English sentence can be longer than two words. No English sentence can be longer than two words. That's nine words. That's an English sentence. Didn't that just destroy what the person was saying? Yes, that's self-refuting. Absolutely self-refuting. So how does that tie in here? Remember what a scientism proponent is going to say. Only science gives us useful information. And the person says that. So here's my question. Is that understandable and reliable? And can that statement be checked by science? Is that a scientific statement? No. That's a philosophical statement. You can't weigh that statement. You can't measure that statement. You can't put it under a microscope. You can't do anything with it. It's a statement of a philosophy, not science. So if you make that claim, that's not a scientific statement. If it's not a scientific statement, then we can ignore it because the person says only science is useful. Well, then that person made a not useful statement, which means we can throw out this completely. There are more problems with scientism, such as, well, we think we can know non-scientific truth. Remember, scientism says only science gives you truth. Only science. Don't count on your experiences. Don't count on theology. Don't count on a holy book. And don't count on your gut-level intuitions. Only science. When it comes from a microscope, when it comes out the end of a telescope, then you've got something that you can count on. But honest to goodness, let's just take intuition, and we could again spend a lot of time on this. Let's just take one thing. If I say to you, torturing babies for fun is wrong. Torturing babies for fun is wrong. I know that without having to go to a class, a laboratory, read a scientific book, talk to a scientist, listen to some kind of DVD on science. I know that. I didn't need science to tell me that. And you can probably think of a thousand things that your intuition, which is to me is God-breathed, it's part of us, God placed eternity in our hearts, it says in the Bible. These kinds of truths we know. In Romans it says, we know the truth, we suppress it. God's qualities are out there for us. We know that the innocent should be protected. We know that courage is better than cowardice. We don't need science to tell us these things. We know love is better than hate. There are just certain things that we know. A gut level reaction. Well, if we can know those things, that just throws scientism out the window. One more problem. It doesn't allow for free will. I would say that's one of the key things that makes us people, doesn't it? When we look at animals and they do things by instinct, they're not operating on free will. People, on the other hand, do operate by free will. You decided to marry or not marry, that was your choice. You decided what kind of car to get. You decided whether to show up or not here today. You made 1,000 decisions before you got out of the house this morning. Now, is all that just a fake? Is it just an illusion? Or do you think you actually have free will? Well, a UCLA neuroscientist said people absolutely have free will. He's dealt with people who've come in with some terrible addictions and different emotional problems. And he said the ones that say, I can change, I will change. He said it's the mental outlook. They have a will that says, I will do this, and they change and they become better people. We absolutely have free will. Scientism says no. Remember, it's only that box. Only the box, and in the box are material things. In other words, with our brain, we just have chemicals, we have neurons firing, we have a mass brain, but we don't have free will. It's those neurons, and it's that chemical bath that we're in, that makes us do what we're doing. So Adolf Hitler wasn't really wrong. Mother Teresa shouldn't be praised. The Pope shouldn't be acknowledged as a good spiritual person. They're just doing what their chemical bath told them to do. There's no free will. Why should we give somebody a reward for heroism? Why should we boo the bad guy in a movie? There's no free will. It's just that box full of parts. Third, it ruins human experiences. I gave you one example already, remember? Talking about love. Richard Dawkins says love is just, again, kind of a chemical reaction going on. Erwin Schrödinger, a physicist, I love what he says. Science cannot tell us a word about why music delights us, of why and how an old song can move us to tears. Isn't that true? Can you weigh anything in the laboratory to come up with an answer to this? Why did that music swell up in your soul? Why do you have tears in your eyes when you hear something, when you watch something? Why does a sunset cause our spirits to lift? If you're into scientism, you say, no, the only truth is that that sunset is just the way the light waves are being refracted. They would say music is just a bunch of sound waves that come in and hit our ears. Well, that's not delight or non-delight, it's just sound waves. So you're just reducing it all to that stuff in the box. Science can't tell us any of these things. The things that make life worth living. The music, the love, family. Any of these things that lift us and make us feel proud to be a human, happy to be alive. It ruins experiences if scientism is true. One final problem with scientism. It doesn't tell us about the important things in life. Oh, sure. It can tell you, by the way, I'm not trying to put down science at all. But scientism, if it says only truth that science deals with is the only truth you need for your life, it's leaving out the most important things of life. Honest to goodness, if you're asked to make a list of what's important to you, I don't think it's going to be the force of gravity. I don't think it's going to be the weight of an iron atom. I don't think it's going to be the level of the tides. I think you're going to put down people you love, the good experiences that you've had in life, a good book, sitting in front of a fire. Those kinds of things are what make your life useful and make you feel happy to be a person. Here's Schrodinger again. He's a Nobel Prize winner, by the way. He's talking about this. He said the scientific picture of the real world is what? Deficient. It's not complete. It gives a lot of factual information. Oh, yes, definitely. I love science. I think it's great. We've just sent a little tiny robot out past Pluto, of all things. Nobody knew anything about Pluto. And all of a sudden now we have a map. Pluto's a real world. So it gives us a lot of factual information, absolutely. But it is ghastly silent about all that's near to our heart that really matters to us. It cannot tell us a word about physical pain, physical delight. It knows nothing of beauty, knows nothing about what's ugly of life. In other words, you can't look at a work of art and say, well, let's talk about the composition of the oil. That's not beauty and that's not ugly. It's something that affects our soul. It can't talk about good or bad. What's good? What's bad? Those are crazy terms when you're talking scientism. There's nothing good, nothing bad. It's just stuff. Remember, it's that box again. It's just those things that are in the box. And it certainly can't talk about God or eternity. Isn't that a big question? What happens to us? Well, think about the big questions of life. Where did we come from? Science isn't sure. Why are we here? Science has no answer. How do we fix the human race? Science has no answer. What happens to us when we die? Science has no answer. The big things of life, God and our eternity, it says eternity destination, it's not around. There's no information coming from science on these things. Not a word about our own ultimate destination. Where are we going to end up? Science has to say, don't know. We're just in that box. That's all we're going to talk about. Yeah, but I want to know, once I'm down in the ground, is that it? I would live a very different kind of life. Is there something I need to worry about beyond the grave? Science says you're on your own. Those are pretty important issues. So, conclusion, let's wrap this up. Science and Christianity are not enemies. There's no clashing going on. Remember, that's an invented story, especially two people that invented that in the 1800s to put down Christianity. There is a clash. The clash is not between science and Christianity. It's between Christianity and those that carry science so far to say that science is all there is, sometimes called naturalism. There's your clash. Is there a God? Is there not? And certainly that is a clash, and that's gone on as long as people have been around. We do appreciate science. I hope you walk out of here, and I hope you don't think that I'm saying bah humbug to science. No. I love what science has done. Aren't you glad there are vaccinations these days? Aren't you glad dentistry has gotten a lot better? Ooh. I used to hate dentists when I was a kid. It was pretty painful. Science, it's done some wonderful things. It extends our lives. It gives us phones that are unbelievably powerful. We can watch things on television from around the world. We can, as I mentioned, there's that mission that went out past Pluto. It's telling us all sorts of information about this universe. That's great. I love that. But it has its limitations. It can only deal with stuff. And it shouldn't be telling us that stuff is all there is. They just need to say, we're just dealing with the stuff. Okay. But there could be the interaction with God from further outside the box. Scientists, another thing to keep in mind, scientists sometimes speak out of the area that they are an expert in. Just because somebody has some degrees after his or her name doesn't mean they can make pronouncements about everything. Carl Sagan, the universe is all there ever was and all there ever is and all there ever will be. How does he know that? Has he lived forever? That's a statement way beyond what a human should be able to make. He cannot say that about the future, and he cannot say that about the past. We need to encourage Christians to go into sciences. Oh, absolutely. Let's not treat science as the dirty thing not to get involved with. We need Christians in the motion picture industry. We need Christians to be scientists. And finally, the goal of science should be what? Truth. No matter where it takes us. No matter where it takes us. Not truth confined to a box, but any place that it can take us. So, I hope this helped you today. I hope you have some clear ideas about science. Feel good. Science is not going to destroy your faith. Christianity is going to stand tall. Science will just reinforce what we've said. I've got other talks that mention recent scientific discoveries and how they're showing us that there's a God. They're pointing strongly to the idea of a God.